Hello, 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 and welcome back to the More Money Podcast. I'm your host, Sarah Moorhouse. You did hear that right. It's not Jessica Moorhouse.
I'm here, though.
Yeah. It is her sister. I'm taking over for the podcast today.
What she's going to be doing. So we came up with this idea because I wanted to, like, I brought my podcast equipment when I was coming home to Vancouver to visit my family. And, you know, I didn't really have an idea what the episode would be about. So I thought we'd just figure it out when I was there. But she came up with a great idea that she would kind of turn the tables and interview me because I have never been interviewed on my own show. And I've been doing this show for over 6 years now. So I'm like, that's a great idea. I mean, she knows me pretty darn well, but also as someone now who works for me, I guess, and part of her job is actually listening to each and every one of these episodes before they go live. She has a really good sense of what the show is about. And so I think it'll be an interesting conversation that we have. She has a bunch of notes and questions written down.
I do have notes.
Okay. So where did you want to start?
Let's start from the beginning.
Okay. Where do you want to start? Like, but actually though. Like, how far back do we want to go?
Let's start. Well, I want to center this episode around going freelance, going, you know, be it if you have a side hustle, you're wanting
to. And this
to-
is because you have gone freelance this year. And so it's a journey.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I want to go back to your story and see how that all came to be. I mean, I know it very well.
Yeah. And I feel like I honestly haven't shared that many details on the show because I feel like the last time I really talked about it, probably in a solo episode, it was still a bit fresh. And I was afraid that someone from my old job would, know what I felt and not give me a reference. But I've been doing running my own business for almost 5 years now. And so I don't really care. I'm not going to use any of those people as my references. So I'm good. I can, you know, spill the tea, so to speak, if you will, as the kids say.
The tea is piping hot.
The tea is piping hot and ready to be spilled. Anyways, so where should I start? Let me go back to, I think, because I get this question a lot, is why did you decide to quit your, you know, corporate job that seemed kind of fine in the face of it? I mean, you know, it was a pretty big risk to take. Why did you do that? And the real reason is, it's not like I had this big plan. And especially too, if you're a longtime listener, you'll remember some of my early episodes, especially I think it was like episode one, possibly, with my husband, who's been self-employed for as long as I've known him. I'm like, I can never do that. I will never become self-employed. Not for me. I liked the comfort and security of working for a company. And I still do miss a lot of aspects of that. Don't get me wrong. And that's why I have so many, I find, issues when I go online, go on Instagram. There's all these people talking about how amazing it is to be self-employed. And they're really, they're only telling half the story, guys. So I think being an employee is great. However, my particular situation, I, you know, at that point I'd been working for different companies, full time, different, you know, positions for over 7 years. I was with my current company for over 2 years when it all kind of happened, and this sounds super cheesy, but, it all kind of happened when I turned 30 and had a bit of a, you know, quarter life crisis, I suppose. Turned 30, had a good look at my life and was like, I'm not happy. I don't like my life. This is not where I thought I'd be at this point in my life. I'm just like honestly miserable, to be honest. And part of that was because of my job. I mean, I spent all my time at my job, really. I didn't feel valued. I wasn't getting paid enough. I was promised a promotion that never came to fruition. I was doing way more work than what I was hired for, all of these things. And so I basically came to, you know, the decision to, I'm going to leave no matter what. I interviewed at a lot of different companies, actually.
Did you ever say what you used to do?
I don't know if I actually did. I don't know. But my last job was with a big Bay Street law firm in Toronto. I worked in digital marketing and did a lot of the things actually that I do now for my own business. So social media, web, you know, graphic design, website stuff, blogging, all this kind of stuff. So it was very relevant and it was great because no one really knew what I did, I think. Because, I mean, it's a law firm. They don't know. And lawyers, God bless them, don't know anything about social media. So I did a lot of that. So when I made that decision to, you know, exit, definitely started applying in a bunch of different places. I'll start doing research on like, okay, if I, you know, maybe don't find a company that I want to kind of jump ship to, if I do this on my own, you know, start, because I did have the side hustle at the time, what would that look like? And, you know, when you're kind of doing research like that, it just looks like I'm researching for my job, which is always convenient. But basically, I, you know, did a lot of interviews. There was just nothing that got me super excited. And it just came to a point where I'm like, I need to quit this job. Mm-hmm. And I'm not one of those people that believes that you should necessarily quit your job before you have something lined up. But for me, and I've talked to so many people in my Instagram DMs and over email over the years about this, it really came to a point where I was like, it is critical for my own mental health, that I quit, because it really was. And now that I have this perspective, such a toxic work environment, it was affecting how I thought about myself. I really felt like kind of worthless, and was drinking too much, was spending money that I shouldn't have just so I could feel something. All of these things. I was just, you know, not in a very good place. It was a bit of a dark place. And so I gave 2 months notice in November of 2016. And also, talk about risks. Me and my husband had just bought our first home. So that was a bit scary, but he was very supportive. But, you know, I kind of had a very, you know, sizable emergency fund, because I think I was like hoarding money, getting ready for this big change. But also, like, I wasn't like, oh, I'm going to quit and show them. I gave them 2 months notice so they can change their mind, so they can give me that promotion raise that they promised. I literally was hoping that would be the case and everything would be fine.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. That's why I gave 2 months notice.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I was really hoping they changed their mind. You know, when you hear like stories, or you watch, you know, a movie or TV show, and they're like, oh, I'm going to, you know, basically use the leverage of like, fine, well, I'll quit unless you give me that promotion.
Yeah.
And, yeah. Yeah. Well, I kind of did that and it didn't work out and I actually had to quit. So I would say never kind of put them in that position, kind of like that threat of like, well, I'll quit then, unless you are actually willing to quit, because you may have to quit. And I did.
Yeah. It's interesting, because I think you've said that a lot of people in your life were shocked that you wanted to go freelance and, you know, go and work on your own business. I was not.
Really?
I always thought you were going to work for yourself.
Oh, I never had that plan at all. Ever.
I don't know why. I always had that sense. So I probably was maybe one of the few who was like, oh, okay, yeah, sure, do it.
Interesting. Yeah, it's not that people weren't supportive, though. Mom certainly was concerned, to say the least. I mean, she just didn't understand, because she'd been an employee, same with my dad, you know, our dad for forever. And so why would you quit a stable, totally fine, you know, sort of well-paying corporate job where you could, if you just stick it out, work your way up, why would you quit that for uncertainty? And I understand that it does look a bit crazy, especially since, like to give everyone a reference point, no one in our families on both sides, uncles, cousins, aunts, no one is self-employed. No one runs their own business. Everyone is an employee. And even going back to like our grandparents and all this, no one that I know of in our family is self-employed. And so it's a bit of a crazy idea.
Our dad's father ran his own business.
He did have a bakery. That's true. He did have his own business.
He did run his own business.
Yeah, that's true. So that's like one person.
One person out of how many?
How many? And so for me to make that decision, it was a bit, everyone just didn't quite understand.
Yeah.
And even friends, actually all of my friends are also work, you know, as employees.
Yeah.
They were, you know, like, oh, okay. But and supportive in general, but like didn't quite understand why someone would do that. And to be fair, I didn't understand why people were self-employed before I became self-employed. So I totally get it at all. I totally get it.
I think it's a lot. Well, definitely with pandemic times, it's maybe less shocking.
Well, yeah. I mean, because everyone's been kind of forced to
work from home,
you know,
in some
work
way,
from home, or then start a side hustle. So freelancing is definitely a lot more, I think, popular or more mainstream now than it was 5 years ago.
I definitely think it is. But I do think that there's still the misconception that if you're working for yourself, you're working at home, you're self-employed, that it means you have like more time to do non-work things.
Yeah.
And that your schedule is complete. Like, you know, yeah. I always find that there's this idea that's sold. You're just, oh, I'm going to go freelance. I'm just going to work on a beach.
Yeah.
And make my money doing whatever.
Number one, you cannot work on a beach with a laptop because of the sun glare.
I know.
So let's just kill that dream.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
cannot work with a laptop on a beach. I've tried. It's impossible.
Yeah. I mean, I guess that goes into my next question is, what's the biggest misconception people have about going, you know, and it could be anything. It could be starting, yeah, just starting your own side hustle or, but yeah, mainly working for yourself. Like, because there's this thing I saw on Instagram the other day where someone's saying, I quit my 9-to-5 so that I could work 24/7.
Yeah, that's 100% true. Well, that's the thing I see, yeah, a lot on social media, these mainly, and I've been having this issue, I feel like, with, you know, certain influencers on social media who are like kind of business coaches or whatever, promoting this idea that you're basically a chump for working a 9-to-5. You're slaving away, giving away all your hours to some evil corporation when you could be working for yourself and living your best life. And that is a dream. That is not the reality. As someone who's been running her own business for full time for over almost 5 years, it'll be 5 years in January. And it's been going, you know, well, it's still a slow and steady kind of journey. And that first year, especially, because even though I did kind of have a foundation, I had my side hustle, I did earn about, I don't know, $20,000 to $30,000. The, you know, when I was working full time, that was the side hustle. So I'm like, okay, well, if I put full time hours towards this, I should be able to at least, you know, earn or out earn the salary that I'm leaving behind. So that gave me some comfort. But I still didn't really have much of a business plan. Didn't quite know what all the different things that can come your way. I really didn't know what I was doing. I don't have a business background, and so. Did a ton of research, of course, and tried a lot of things and failed a lot of things. If anyone has been a longtime listener, you may remember my failed attempt at trying to merge fitness and finance in Rich and Fit, this wonderful, cute idea that I had with my friend Jackie that did not work out, but we're both doing well, and she's good in the fitness world. I'm good in the finance world. Just didn't work together.
No, unfortunately.
You know, so there's I worked all the time. I worked every single weekend. I worked 10 to 12 hour days for an entire year. And I definitely was getting very close to burnout. And so I understand when I see that meme that, you know, work 24/7. Absolutely. It's not like that anymore. But that's because I have been doing this for a while. I figured out different, you know, revenue streams. I've also, especially this year, I've started to actually hire out because I'm now making enough money in my business that I can hire contractors for things like my wonderful podcast editor, my wonderful sister who helps me with a ton of different things in my business. My YouTube videos, most of those are now edited by someone I hire just so I have more time to do other things. So, but, you know, for 4 years before that, I did every single thing myself. And also the thing that you don't hear about, sometimes you know, do research and you're like, oh, just, you know, outsource. You know how hard it is to find good people? Like, I've worked with lots of different, you know, VAs or contractors, and they were awful, and I had to fire them. So it's not as easy as just hire someone to help you. It's like, yeah, but you have to hire someone who's good.
And reliable
and also affordable. Like, you also don't want to, you know, sometimes it is you get what you pay for, but I've also paid a lot of money for people that don't really deliver. Yeah. So it's not as easy as there's so many things that go into running your own business. That's not to deter anyone. I mean, I love, like, I wouldn't give up what I'm doing now for the world. I absolutely love what I'm doing. Yeah. But I think the kind of messaging that's out there is that it's easy, you have more free time, and also that there's a negative about being an employee, which I don't agree with.
I think
that's
either.
Ridiculous, because I actually, in general, liked being an employee. I liked having that stability and that certainty, and generally, I liked the jobs that I did.
Yeah.
Sometimes I would get bored. Usually, it was just like the culture, the environment, the people I worked with.
Yeah.
You know, you can't really control those things.
No.
Yeah.
And I think... I don't see anything wrong with having a regular job.
Yeah.
Like, I think it's more so, yes, this weird narrative where you're less cool, or I don't know. It's so odd. I don't get it.
Yeah.
For me, going freelance was very different.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's different. And Ever since I graduated university, for OGs, if you do remember that episode we did.
I'll even have to find it. I don't remember what episode that is, but I'm sure I didn't take it off the podcast,
It's still there. I don't know what number it is.
It's got to be like 5 years old. I'll try to find it and I'll link it in the show notes.
It would be 5 years old. Yeah.
So just jumping in here, because I honestly couldn't remember this episode. It was so long ago. Yeah, apparently Sarah was on the podcast in 2016, June 25th, 2016. She was on episode 53. So I think this was after I did a full year of the podcast, or maybe it was like the last episode of the first season or what have you. I don't know. But anyways, if you want to check it out, it is episode 53. You can check it out on my website, jessicamoorhouse.com/53, or try to find it in the archives of wherever you're listening to this show.
But and we're talking about, you know, because I just graduated university, and I always had the sense that I don't suit the yeah. corporate lifestyle. Yeah. And I knew that in some capacity I'd want to work for myself. And that's ever evolving. Yeah. You know, I've only been self-employed since the start of this year. And it's still, it's like ever evolving. And I have to remind myself, like, this is, you know, just take every week as it is and all that. And things will evolve and things will grow. And that's what's happened in your own business. Things, how your business looked, I'm sure, from 5 years ago to now. Very different.
Very different. Very, very different. And that's another thing. It's like, that's natural for it to evolve. Yeah. I feel like we get so hung up. One thing that I've tried to get rid of is this idea I'm a perfectionist. It is something that I need to work on every single day, but getting rid of this idea that things need to be perfect before they can be released, launched, done, or considered done. Because it, you know, certain things took me years to get off the ground, just because it's like, it wasn't perfect. But done is actually better than perfect.
Yeah. I remind myself of that as well.
Yeah. That's, I mean, I tell you that as well. It's like, it's really not about being perfect. People just want
it done. Get whatever they want done.
Yeah. And just like good enough, like not good enough, but like done. Well, that's it. I don't need something that's perfect.
No.
Because nothing is really perfect.
No. And your perfect might be different than my
absolutely.
Perfect. So
absolutely.
It's not an attainable thing.
No. Perfection is not attainable. So don't even bother, because it will just, the biggest, I think, struggle in my business, and, you know, because I know so many other entrepreneurs and small business owners, you know, some of which do very similar things to me. You know, I have lots of friends who do very similar things. That's what we talk a lot about is this, a couple things. It's that struggle with perfectionism. Also that analysis paralysis. There's so many things you can do, and then it's hard to actually pick one thing to actually do. Imposter syndrome. Every single person I have ever met, even super, super successful people deal with imposter syndrome.
Does that ever go away?
No. It doesn't. You just have to manage.
Great.
It's just something that you manage. Like, honestly, and I don't know if I've really shared this on the podcast, maybe a little bit, but you know, for the past year, I've been working with a therapist, and he has been amazing. He also like specifically works with everybody, but he does. I worked with him specifically because he has experience with people who run their own businesses and some of the issues that they deal with. And yeah, imposter syndrome was a big issue, because it's like, when will this go away? How many courses do I need to take, or credentials do I need to get in order for me to feel good enough? What I've realized is like, it's never really going to go away. So it is something you just need to manage, have some tools in your toolbox to figure out how to deal with it. And then also realize, like, the thing that I'm currently doing is very public facing. And so I'm always going to encounter, as someone who looks young, even though I'm not as young as I look, and I'm a woman, I will always encounter people who will question everything that I do. I mean, every single day I will get a comment on, you know, social media or YouTube or even a nasty email telling me I don't know what I'm talking about, even though I know way more than those people. Because I do. Because I've actually done the work. I've been doing this for almost a decade.
Yes.
I'm on my way to become a financial planner. Like, I know more than you. But so that's something that I have to deal with every single day, is people telling me you're an idiot or anything. I mean, I get comments on, I don't look at my podcast reviews anymore, because most of them are really, really mean, that have usually nothing to do with me.
No.
But they just want to project something, and usually it is like sexist or whatever.
It's on them.
It's on them. What can you do?
What can you do? Going back to, you know, that whole, like, the culture of, you know, self-employed and everything, mm-hmm. it does tie in with hustle culture.
Yeah.
So what are...
The rise and grind culture. Yeah. Yeah.
I hate that.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I know a lot of people kind of in my circle and community that are, you know, entrepreneurs are also rejecting this idea because I think a lot of us subscribed to it, did it,
yeah.
and burned out. And yeah. or had, you know, it made a lot of other issues flare up that we, you know, it's not a healthy way to live, the whole kind of Gary Vee. And I actually like Gary Vee, but I don't like this idea that you need to grind, 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 hustle, hustle, hustle every single day. Because again, it's like, wait a minute. I thought the whole point was to enjoy life. I thought this was supposed to be better than the 9 to 5. Like I didn't, I didn't grind this hard at my 9 to 5.
Yeah. That's my gripe with it is like, what are you hustling for?
Well, I think that's the other thing that I've had to really define in my own business is, a lot of people just hustle and do all the things in order to, make a lot of money, get a lot of followers.
Yeah.
Because those are the kind of two big things that people use as a benchmark for success.
Yeah.
And for me, it's like, I have never had a thing that's just like taken off. You know, mm-hmm. I've never had a thing where mm-hmm. it's like overnight, I have all these followers, or mm-hmm. overnight, I've made all this money. I've been doing this for almost a decade, and it literally has been like the tortoise and the hare kind of thing. Like I'm the tortoise, and as much as I would like to run as a tortoise, I just cannot with my little legs. And so I'm just like walking very slow, eventually going to get to whatever the finish line is.
And hustle culture would make you believe that you're failing because you haven't had anything take off. When in 100%. Actuality, that's not true.
No, but it does. I mean, that's something that I have to encounter every single day going on Instagram and stuff is there's people that are like, wow, they've been doing this 6 months and they have more Instagram followers than me.
But it's like at the end of the day, okay, sure, you might have how many odd Instagram followers, but do those convert into mm-hmm. what your business needs them to convert into? So customers, sales.
Yeah, it's like, those are just kind of, in my opinion, vanity metrics. But also like for me, I had to really recognize, like I always, and this is something that I practice every single day, is reminding myself, okay, what is like the mission or the purpose of my business? And it's like, well, I quit my corporate job in order to do something that I'm passionate about, A, but also B, I want to help people. I've, I'm sure talked about this on the podcast so many times, but I feel like kind of purpose in life, or my kind of raison d'etre, if you will, is to help people. I really love being able to affect people in a positive way. Mm-hmm. Because so many other people, especially like going specific to personal finance, have affected me and changed my life. Like there's certain books that changed my life, certain bloggers that I read their blog inspired me and changed my life. People I've met in the personal finance community that have just like been so inspiring. I want to be able to do that. How cool would that be? And so that is the number one kind of purpose for what I'm doing. It's not followers and it's not money. I mean, because also like sometimes I think I'm like, what am I going to do? Like, you know, see all these people. I mean, I've had lots of people on the show who have been reached financial independence, you know, fire people.
Yes.
You know, at an early age. And I think that's great. Good for them. But for me, I'm like, I don't want to hustle that hard or live a different lifestyle than I'm living right now in order to just get $1 million by the time I'm 30 or 40, you know, or whatever. I'm doing what I'm doing and it's working and I'm building my wealth. I'm paying down my mortgage. I'm being responsible with my money, but I don't think I'd be happier if I, you know, reach that FI number by a certain timeline. Like, you know what I mean?
I think the difference with your career trajectory is that it's about longevity.
Yeah. I just want something for me that's sustainable. And that's what I try to, I think, talk about on the show is being like creating a process and mm-hmm. a lifestyle that's sustainable. I don't like things that are kind of like a crash diet. Lots of these kind of fire things where it's like, I'm going to, you know, reach this by 30. Like I see that all the time on Instagram. I'm going to achieve this by 30. And now that I'm 35, I'm like, well, I missed that boat. But also, you know, it's not sustainable because it's like, not. What did you, and also again, let's be real. And this is, I think this is something that bugs me a lot is lots of people are not very transparent about, well, how did you actually
reach
that
money goal?
Right? And usually it's because they earned, you know, a very high salary from an early age. Maybe they had, you know, like right out of high school or not high school, sorry, university. And maybe they didn't have any student loans. That makes a big difference.
There's so many factors.
There's so many factors. And so that's the thing that I always kind of try to share on all my channels is, you know, good for them, not for you. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what anyone else is doing. What matters is what you're doing. So that's something, again, I'm always constantly reminding myself, like, I'm doing this so I can run a business that makes me excited to get up in the morning.
Yes.
I'm creating content and courses and education that is going to help people, because that's really what I want to do.
Yes.
And really all I want in terms of like success, like what does that mean to me, is just getting that feedback from, mm-hmm. you know, listeners,
yeah.
course students, people that buy my budget spreadsheets. Hey, this really helped me. And then earning enough that I can pay my bills, go on some vacations, retire at 65. I'm good.
Yeah.
Like I feel super blessed and lucky to be able to say that I even have that. I don't need to be Oprah. I don't need to be like the wealthiest person out there or have a TV show or whatever. Obviously, I wouldn't say no if someone wants to offer that to me, but that's not the goal, because I don't feel like, from all the people I've talked to over the years who do have those things, who have a lot of money, who have a TV show, who have booked it, have, you know, all these kinds of things that when you look at it, you're like, oh, that sounds so cool. They're not happier because of that stuff. Mm. It's the stuff that brings them joy usually is the simple things like family. I get to take time off when I want to, whatever the case. It's that kind of stuff, that material stuff, or the stuff that we think will make you happy. It isn't. And another thing that I also want to mention, because I see this a lot on social media. I mean, talk about this a lot. I'm on social media a lot because of the pandemic. Okay.
We all are.
But it's this idea that money is the solution to all of your problems. It sure as hell can help a lot of your problems, but money itself shouldn't be the goal, because it should be, well, what are you going to do with that money?
Yes.
Right? What is that money going to provide to you? And usually then you'll actually find the real answer, which is security, comfort, just peace of mind. Mm-hmm. Those are the things that you actually want. It's not the money. The money can help you get that. So that's why we need to kind of move away from this idea that I'm going to be a millionaire by this age, or I'm going to be a billionaire. I see that now. Yeah, it's not even cool to be a millionaire. You have to be a billionaire now.
The idea that we forget that money is a means to an end.
Yeah, it's just a tool.
It's just a tool.
It will not, in and of itself, make you happy, because there's a lot of people out there who have a lot of money that are not happy. There's a lot of people that don't have a lot of money that are way happier than those millionaires.
True. You know? I mean, would I rather be sad on a yacht?
Sure.
Sure. But
you're still sad.
You're still sad. So,
right? I know.
That does lead me really nicely to my next question about the fact that you have a very front-facing career.
Yeah. You mean like I'm out there.
You're out there. Eyes are on you.
Eyes are on me.
What does that feel like?
Weird. Honestly, I try not to think about it. And also, like, I do keep a lot of things private. I am starting to share a lot more. And I think what most people don't really realize is the reason I've never shared like my maybe it's as popular now, but you know, when I first started blogging, people would share their budgets, they would share their income, they would share their net worth numbers. I never did that because I was embarrassed because I was broke. I was in my 20s and broke, so I was kind of ashamed, quite honestly, which is ridiculous. I shouldn't have been ashamed, because I was making, you know, progress, and you shouldn't be comparing yourself to others. But anyway, but a big reason why I don't share some of my numbers is because it is kind of linked to my husband. He is part of, you know, he's part of my family. And you know, we do things together, and he really wants to keep that, you know, some of those numbers private. So when I do share my numbers, it really is just my money. It has nothing to do with, so it's like, you know, my portion of the house and then all of my kind of stuff. But that, like, I basically want to respect the people that I need to respect, because I don't want to. He's been so supportive. Obviously, we've been together 14 years. He's just like, just don't share too much about that stuff, because it affects me too, you know.
There's also the idea that boundaries are great.
Boundaries, exactly.
And setting them is healthy. Everyone doesn't need to know everything.
No, they don't need to. And also, like, my whole, you know, platform is about helping you as the listener, as the course student. It's not the message, and something that used to be, I feel like, something that I felt bad about. I'm like, it's not about me, because I don't really have a great, amazing story. I didn't pay $100,000 in debt in 2 years. I didn't reach $1 million by 30. You know, I didn't do anything crazy.
Yeah.
But I feel like I've actually been doing well, and I'm happy with how things are. And also, like, the other thing is, like, I have been taking, you know, all of these years to not only do all this research and self-learn, self-educate myself, but also doing proper training so I can be a better educator to you. You know, first I became an accredited financial counselor. Now I'm on the path to become eventually a CFP. And so that's why I'm like, I don't think it's super important for me to share how much money I have or how much my business earns. Because why do you care how much my business earns? How, like, at the end of the day, you're coming to this podcast, you're going on my blog, you're going on my YouTube channel or following me because you want to know how to help yourself. Who cares about me? You know what I mean? Like, when I want to learn something, like, how do I bake bread? I don't care how much money that person on Instagram with the bread Instagram makes on his bread business.
No,
I just want to know how to make bread. You know what I mean?
No.
And so that's something I'm always very mindful of. It's like, is this actually helpful or is this just to give myself a pat on the back? If it's not helpful, then I'm not going to share it.
As your sister, and now who's someone who, you know, works with you, that it is interesting that, you know, I forget that the people say YouTubers I watch or, you know, different podcasts that I listen to, where how I feel about those people, like, oh, they're so cool. People think that way about you.
Yeah, I don't think about that. That's weird. That's a weird thing to think about. And also, that seems like a bit pompous for me to be like, well, like, please.
But I think,
literally, whenever I think about that, there's another voice in my head being like, get over yourself, Jessica. You're a personal finance content creator, the nerdiest niche in the world.
I know. And, but that reminds me of that someone, you asked an Instagram question and someone said, like, oh, you know, a little bit cheeky, like, oh, like, what does it feel like to have a sister who's famous?
Oh, yeah.
I don't think of you as famous.
Well, no, because I'm not.
Because you're not.
You know,
yeah,
I think, yeah, fame to me is like, I don't know, like Jennifer Lawrence or something,
like,
you know,
a movie,
like,
star,
someone who's like a movie star, yeah, or something like, yeah, that, yeah, you know,
yeah, yeah. But I mean, I definitely, from working on the back end of your stuff, I do see that, you know, as opposed to all the people who have, you know, their platforms are really based on, yeah, they're
yeah,
working towards a number goal, which we all love to read those stories. We all love to read those stories.
Sure, I'm so nosy and so curious about what everyone's doing with their money. For sure. Love that.
Yeah. However, most of the time, not relatable.
No.
Because, like, personally, it's not like I'm working towards, oh, I have to be a millionaire by the time I'm 30. I mean, clock's a ticking, not going to happen.
No.
But I see that for you and, like, if we weren't sisters.
Yeah.
I know why people would follow you.
Oh, why?
Because of the relatability.
Oh, good.
And I mean, yeah, it's the, you're just like regular Jess.
Because I am, you know? Literally, that's all I got.
I know.
Right?
Right.
Like, that's what I think defaulted to, because I'm like, okay, I don't have any like special story. So maybe let's just try being me.
Yeah.
Give it a go and see what happens. And a big, like, way I did that was starting the podcast, because it's me talking and there's no hiding behind a fancy photo or whatever. Not that I know how to take a good Instagram picture. No idea how to do that.
That's hard.
Something I don't, and I'm never going to learn how. I just don't care. I just don't know how. I think I'm too old to learn how to, like,
do some
of those poses.
No.
But anyways, I don't care enough to do that. So the podcast was a great way for people to get to know me as me, not just like an image or text or something like that, where people can kind of make their own maybe assumptions, but they can hear me and my voice and my thoughts and be like, oh, okay, I think I kind of get a sense of who this person is.
Totally. Yeah. Definitely one, moving away from a bit of that, maybe more selfishly.
Yeah.
I want to know motivation.
Yeah.
Elusive as self-employed people.
So how do you motivate yourself as if you're self-employed? Yeah. Well, so yeah, you need to create your own goals and benchmarks. So what I have done for definitely the past 5 years, especially, it really started when I first quit my job, became self-employed. So this all kind of happened. The new kind of life journey happened, it started in January 2017. Mm-hmm. And I was actually talking to one of my husband's friends, who's a very successful realtor, very, you know, ambitious. He's doing so many great things. I'm always like in awe of him. And he says one of the things that he does, he's like, I know it sounds cheesy, but I make a vision board every single year of what I want to accomplish. And almost every year I accomplish almost everything. So it's not about being, again, perfect, but if you put some, you know, again, use like the SMART goals, the SMART action. Wait, what is it? What is it? Specific, measurable, actionable, realistic, and time-based.
Very
kind
good.
Of, yes, I know. Finally memorized that. Kind of method of making goals and then create a visual representation of those goals, which I try to do. Sometimes I get lazy and I just like put post-its on my corkboard in my office. So I see them every single day. So yeah, it's not quite visual, like a pretty magazine photo or whatever. But, you know, just something that I can look at every day to be like, what are we going to accomplish this year? And you can do that for your life goals, your career goals, mm-hmm, business goals, whatever. And I've definitely, it's definitely been something that I've fine tuned. You know, sometimes I, you know, the first couple of years put too many goals and feel terrible because I didn't accomplish all of them. Now I like to stick to maybe five goals, maybe okay, six or something. And they, again, are like, I know I can achieve them if I just follow through. Mm-hmm. And so having set those goals at the beginning of the year or whenever you want, it's never too late to set goals, and then putting them someplace that you see every single day, so they're always front of mind. And also when you're like in that kind of state of business where you feel overwhelmed, you're really busy, and then you're kind of like, what am I even doing? You know, you have so many things on your to-do list. Then you can take a look, wait, what are the goals again? And let's take a look at the to-do list to see what connects to those goals. Sometimes there'll be like things on your to-do list, you're like, this isn't actually helping me achieve my goals. So why did I put that on the to-do list? Like, there's so many things that I find myself get excited about. Like, for instance, I just recently worked with I hired a brand strategist so she can help me, you know, create new fonts and colors and really create a good visual for my brand. Cause everything I've done it myself. And I'm like, I don't know. I don't even like the color pink. How is that my brand color? So I needed someone to help me with that. And I'm like, oh, I can't wait to just go in and change all of the things that I've got, my website, all the colors. I'm like, whoa. Let's just calm down. You have so many other things that are more important that you do now. Look at your goals. There will be time to update everything. This is not the time. So setting goals is key. Another thing is having then kind of chunkifying them. And being like, okay, so those are the goals. What are the steps to actually achieve those goals? So as an example, one big goal of mine this year was to actually do quite a few courses to become, most likely I'm going to become a QAFP before a CFP, which is a qualified associate financial planner. And in order to do that, there's a number of courses I have to do through the Canadian Securities Institute. And so I created basically like, okay, these are the courses I need to do. I want to do at least two of them. But if I pass the first two, we're going to try to do the other two because they are shorter courses. And then I created a timeline. So basically one course a quarter. So again, creating those goals and then really chunkifying them, because one of my goals is to become a QAFP. Chunkifying them. What do you have to do? What are the steps? Well, I have to pass all these courses. Okay, well, how are you going to pass all those courses? Well, I've got a timeline. Try to study and pass the exam every single quarter of this year. So that should hopefully mean that I...
So just getting really, really specific.
You've got to get really specific, outline everything, write things down. Try different methods. Sometimes, you know, sometimes I like writing things down in a notebook. Sometimes it's a spreadsheet. Sometimes it's a Google Doc, whatever the case. But just get things written down and organized and then literally create that schedule and then just stick to it. So it's kind of like, I feel like sometimes it's like splitting yourself in two, where it's like there's you as the worker and you as the boss, even though you're the same person.
That's a good way to think.
I have Jessica as the boss, and then I've got Jessica as the worker. And sometimes Jessica as the worker can procrastinate and make excuses. Then Jessica, the boss, comes in to be like, hey, remember this whole strategy, this whole kind of timeline and calendar we created? Let's get back to that. So that's been the biggest thing for me. And then also trying different methods. For instance, for like my daily to-do list, I've got, you know, some to-do things that I have to do every single day. And then there's, you know, kind of bigger projects, smaller projects. And sometimes, you know, I write them all down in a notebook and then like to cross them off. Sometimes I find that I'm not looking at my notebook anymore. So that means, oh, okay, I guess that method isn't working. I'm getting a bit too comfortable with it. So let's choose a different, let's use a spreadsheet with a checklist.
Okay.
Or recently I've been using Asana. We use Asana to kind of keep things organized. So sometimes it's about rotating the different methods. If you're like, I'm getting lazy, I'm not using Asana. Okay, let's use the workbook again or something like
that. Okay, yeah, that's very helpful. And, you know, with goals, what about, do you as, maybe more so in the beginning, did you ever have a plan B?
I mean, yeah, the plan B was to get a job.
Oh.
The plan B, yeah, I don't think most people know this. I think I shared this on my Instagram. I can't remember. But my plan was, when I quit my job, I gave myself one year to at least match or beat the salary that I left behind, because that would be proof to me that, okay, this isn't just, you know, you're playing around. This isn't a hobby. This is you, you know, actually making a living. And so I gave myself a year, but if I didn't accomplish that by the year's end, then it'd be time for me to look for another job.
Okay.
And then it wouldn't be the worst thing, because it's like, it's not like I was just hanging out. I was like trying to, but I could put that on my resume that I've learned all these new things. I worked for myself for this year, all this kind of stuff. So that was my plan B, is just to get a job basically. For me now, that's not really my plan. That's always kind of a plan B, I guess.
Yeah. I could definitely get a job if I need to, but
at this point, you know, I think things are going well, because every year my business revenue increases. I have more free time, which means I'm not working harder. I'm working smarter.
Mm-hmm.
And things are just kind of naturally expanding. But also the big thing that's been the biggest difference in my business is what my business actually is. Before, it really was, most of my revenue was from influencer work, working with brands. Now, it's not as much. Honestly, most of it really does come down to, well, I've got my podcast, so I do have ads. So that's, that's not really influencer work, I would say. That's more just like I'm running like a content thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's ads. Like, you know, if I didn't run the podcast, then I wouldn't make money. So I know. So I've got the podcast, of course. Do make some revenue through YouTube, which is just like ads with that. And then I've got my budget spreadsheets. I've got my investing course, Wealth Building Blueprint for Canadians. We'll be releasing another course this fall, which I'm very excited about, which is more on the financial planning front. But the goal for me was always to create a business where I didn't have to rely on working with brands. I just want to work with brands, you know, enough so I can basically pay my bills and have money so I could eventually create my own products and services on my own.
Excellent.
You just want to always, like I tell you all the time, it's so important to have multiple streams of income.
I agree.
But you also don't want to pigeonhole yourself. And also, you know, when I see all these like influencers, you know, online, just being other, I'm like, but you do one wrong thing, you get canceled. Where's that? You have no more money. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Not that
yeah.
I think I'm going to get canceled or, you know, that should be, but it's just one of those things. Just like, you just want to basically recession, in my mind, this is the term I use, and this was something that me and a bunch of women who were on a retreat several years ago chatted about before the pandemic, which is actually funnily enough, we're all talking about how can we recession proof our businesses, because we all were millennials that dealt with the first recession or the last one. How can we, you know, set ourselves up so if something happens, we'll still have a business, we can still make money. And I've been working hard at doing that, and it's so far so good.
So I thought we can now move into, let's do some money talk.
Okay, let's do some money talk.
Because guess what? Some money podcast. It's all
about money. Is. It sure as hell is. Okay, what do you got?
So I was thinking, what is the biggest thing that you think someone should money-wise look into before they start working for themselves? So I mean, taxes, or what do you think is the big, is it taxes?
I mean, well, people always forget about taxes. No, I'd say, honestly, the biggest thing, like before you quit your day job, even if you had like a side hustle like me, where you were generating income from that, before you leave your job, you really should be like, take some time to create a business plan, which I did not do and I regret, because it made that first year of business so much harder. But also, more importantly, have a emergency fund, not just a personal one, but also one for your business.
That was one of my questions.
Yeah, because you
do
know,
you have one for your business?
Yes, because of course you need to have money for your personal, you need to pay your personal bills, like your rent, your utilities, your groceries, but also for your business. I mean, for me, a lot of my business expenses are like monthly subscriptions, because all of these different apps that I use, like my course platform, that's like a monthly subscription, or it could be a yearly subscription that you need to save money in advance for. So if I didn't have money, you know, because there's times where I'm making a lot of money, and then there's times like this summer, every single summer I make hardly any money. I think people don't realize that. And that's usually okay with me, because I try to take time off during the summer.
Yeah.
But it's like almost nothing, for real. But the rest of the year is like, okay, we're doing fine. So you've got to be prepared for those ups and downs of your income. And you do that by having a personal emergency fund. So you can always pay your personal bills, but also a business emergency fund so you can pay your business bills.
Okay. Yeah. That was one of my questions afterwards. So,
yeah. So that's a really important thing. I think another thing that people forget about is, and again, this depends on what your business is, but getting business insurance, so liability insurance. So I think a lot of people too also think that if you incorporate your business, then you're good. You're safe. Mm-hmm, you got this extra liability kind of protection, which you sort of do, but you actually still need business insurance because basically all, you know, incorporating means is someone cannot sue you personally and then take all your personal assets. They can sue your corporation. But again, that means that they can sue your corporation, possibly win. That could be a very expensive court battle. How you pay for all of that is business insurance. So make sure to get some business insurance to protect yourself. And that is goes for if you're incorporated or you're a sole proprietor.
Okay, cool. That's a very good tip. One of mine, and I actually don't think I know the answer to this, is do you have a money philosophy?
That's a good question. I mean, I don't know if I have one that I've like invented myself, but there's definitely some
you don't have to
philosophies
have invented it.
That I live by. I'd say like the one that I learned at a very young age from, and I think I shared this on the podcast, from like a French professor I had in middle school who I think was going through something. He said, you know, be very careful with credit. Never buy anything that you cannot afford to pay, you know, for in cash. So that's something that's, I mean, obviously you can't do that with things like buying a house or sometimes buying a car. But for lots of little things, especially like just those like personal wants, I never buy anything on credit that I cannot afford to immediately pay off that day. So that's one thing that I've just lived by and will always live by.
I live by that as well. I think our mom was very big on that.
Yeah.
Credit cards are not a debit card.
No. She still to this day mainly uses her debit card for purchases. For me, I don't as much. I have like a good system with my credit cards and stuff like that. But but yeah, it's basically like, let's not go crazy because credit cards can be dangerous if you know, it's very easy to spend on them, right?
Very easy. And there's a difference between wants and needs.
Yes, exactly.
So we definitely have that in common.
Yeah. You know, but I'd say like another one that I know you live by too, is just like living within your means.
Yes.
Right. So they kind of go hand in hand. It's like, don't spend more money than you can afford to spend, but really like taking a look at your income level and not, you know, getting caught up in what other people are doing and spending, how they're spending their money. You've got to really just focus on what can we afford or I afford, what makes sense for me and my own personal goals, and then just stay true to that. It can be so easy just to look at what other people are doing and feel like, well, I should have that, or I should buy that, or I'm going to buy that. It's like, but why though?
Yeah. And it leads me to, because your whole business is talking about money and money for, you know, decades and decades has been a very taboo subject. I do talk about money with my friends. Obviously, I talk about it with you and the rest of our family. But, you know, I talk about it with my friends, but I would say it's still a little like, oh, should I ask? Like, oh, you're getting a new job. Like, what's the pay? What's the salary?
Yeah.
I am curious. I would have to ask, do you think it's less taboo now?
I think it's less taboo.
Because of all this personal finance, people are getting more into it. I haven't. Yeah. I say it's a lot more popular.
I think so. Oh yeah. I feel like because of the pandemic, or maybe it's just because I've been online a lot more, I feel like there's so many more people creating content about this and talking about this, which in general I think is really good because we do need to make this just more mainstream and just like a normal thing. You shouldn't have to feel like it's, you know, inappropriate to talk about, hey, are we splitting the bill or can you pay your half and I pay him, you know, or just like asking your friend, hey, do you mind me asking how much you're earning? And then, you know, also on the other side of it, if you don't want to share it, just be like, oh, I'm not really comfortable,
which
is fine. Or, you know, very well, what a lot of people do that I know of who are entrepreneurs, because we, you know, talk a lot about rates and just like how much you're charging for this, so we can help each other. Because, you know, the more we all earn, the more we all earn, you know,
exactly.
I don't want anyone to charge, you know, significantly lower than me if they're doing something similar to me. Because then that means next time that brand will come to me and be like, sorry, we have a smaller budget.
Exactly.
You know, so we don't want that. But, you know, one kind of thing you can do is instead of giving the specific number is giving a range. It's between this and this, just so then you can have an idea of, you know, this is so important, especially when you're looking for a job or interviewing and want to negotiate, really getting clear on what are some ranges. I don't need a specific dollar amount, like 96,000 or 26,000 or whatever. What is the range, so I can have a good kind of idea of where I should start?
That's very good. Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. I'm trying to remember. Do you remember any of the questions that we got from people on Instagram.
Let me check my phone. Okay, so I've got the questions. I'm going to hand them over to you and you can ask.
Oh, I really enjoy this question.
Okay.
Do you and your sister have the same personal finance / investing strategy? Why or why not?
Well, you would know what I'm up to. So what do you think?
I would say we do have very similar personal finance, just philosophies in general, because we grew up in the same house.
Mm-hmm.
We're both major town savers.
Yeah.
We're very afraid of debt.
Yes.
Very afraid of debt.
I hate debt.
I hate it. I think we both, it does, I think, fall into finance category of just the idea of hard work.
Yeah.
Like working hard, and we both work during school. So mm-hmm. we both work during university to pay and for high university. School. And so, yeah, I would say.
I think that's, I mean, those are just things that we grew up with because we grew up, I'd say middle class, but maybe lower middle class.
I would say, yeah, when I was a smaller kid, it was definitely, I would say, lower middle class.
And then, you know, as our parents got older and, you know, got raises and, you know,
yes.
progressed in their careers, obviously there was more money. But, you know, and I had lots of conversations with her mom actually over this trip about, you know, some of our kind of money isms, you know, like mm-hmm. how we are afraid of debt, but we're also kind of afraid of taking chances in terms of risk. And that was something I had actually personally overcome, is the idea that if I start investing my money, I'm going to lose all my money. And that really comes from her parents, our grandparents, because
yes.
they were Depression era. And they also came from very poor families, like poverty. Yes. And you may remember this if you're a longtime listener, but you can definitely find it. And Sarah will put it in the show notes. There is an episode I did with my grandpa. Unfortunately, he is no longer with us, mm-hmm. but it was one of the best things that I've ever done on this podcast, mm-hmm. was be able to learn about his story and just how he literally figured out a way out of poverty. And not an easy thing to do. But because of, you know, kind of our backgrounds, and also like on the, you know, my dad's side of the family, also not rich, you know, that's why I think we have a lot of the things that we have. You know, it's like we're great savers and we're really anti-debt, yes. but also the thing that we all kind of need to work on is this idea of building wealth, the next kind of phase. So that's something that I've definitely learned.
I think, because one of the other questions is, what did our parents teach us about finances growing up? Mm-hmm. And honestly, it was just to save.
It was. That's the biggest thing. And also, they were very transparent in terms of like what we could and couldn't afford.
Yes.
So I know other, you know, families, I'd always be like, oh, how could they afford that trip to Disneyland? Or how could they afford mm-hmm. to buy this new house or mm-hmm. new wardrobe or whatever? And honestly, there was one, I don't know if you remember them, but there were some neighbors of ours years ago when we were kids. And they had a nice house. It was friends with their, you know, daughter, and they had a pool. They had a hot tub. She had those kind of motorized, kid cars or whatever. They had all of these cool toys and everything. And they, after a few years, they had to sell their house because they went bankrupt. They were putting everything on credit. They were just living beyond their means, trying to keep up with the Joneses. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of, for me, you know, even as a kid, because our parents talked about it, like, this is what happened. Like, they could not afford that house. They went bankrupt. They had to sell it and move and all this kind of stuff. It made me really aware of, oh, so it's really, really important to be aware of, you know, credit and debt and all that kind of stuff.
And I would also say, especially our mom, the value of money in mm-hmm. general.
Yeah.
I would say, as opposed to some people, you know, even when I was at university, the fact that I, you know, paid for mm-hmm. school mm-hmm. made me value
your education more.
And mm-hmm. Whereas maybe I had some friends or some people that I met in school who didn't pay for school, mm-hmm. and they were a lot more blasé when it came to mm-hmm. effort.
Yeah.
So,
which isn't to say don't save, you know, money for your kid in an RESP.
I think it's amazing.
We would have loved that.
I would have loved it.
But I think it's also equally important to teach your kids at the same time the value of money and, you know, tell them, where did this money come from? Well, we saved all these years
for
you to go to college. And also, you can take that money away from them.
Yeah.
You don't have to give it to
them. Yeah, I agree.
So really, that's the key thing, isn't it? Is it's not, and I think our parents honestly did a good job, mainly our mom, because she's the money manager of the family, is being open and honest with your kids. Don't be like, oh no, you're too young for that. Or no, it's really inappropriate to talk about money. It's like, in this day and age, no, you need to talk about money and just be transparent. Like, it's not in our budget. And then they'll be like, what's a budget? It's like, well, let me show you what a family budget looks like.
Yeah.
And things like that. Like that, those things had such a huge impact on our how we manage our money today.
I think it's even the little things of, you know, I'm sure same thing. Like when I was in middle school, you know, there's Fat Farms, if anyone remembers that callback of a shoe, but I really wanted them.
I'm like, a what?
Fat Farms. You don't remember that?
Fat Farms? It's pH fat.
Yes.
pH okay. fat. Okay.
But there are, no, or Dorina jeans, if anyone remembers those jeans.
You're 6 years younger, so I have no idea what you're talking about.
But anyways, I wanted these, really wanted these jeans, and quite a few of my classmates had those jeans. Mm-hmm. And mom point blank was like, I am not spending $100 on jeans. You're 13.
Yeah, I know.
And as a 13-year-old, I was like, why?
Yeah.
But as an adult, I was like, fair. That makes sense. And I would have to say that actually, going forward in my adult life, definitely made me think about, okay, when I spend my money, I don't want to just spend it on trends. There has to be a good reason I'm parting with my money.
Yeah.
But yeah, that could also fall back into just, you don't want to be too much of a penny pincher.
No. And believe me, I have lots of pant stories for you. I remember because there's so many trends. I remember in middle school, cargo pants became the big thing and mom refused. Like, there was this great pair and I'm like, oh, I look so great in them. I want these. And the other are too expensive by her standards. And so the only way I can get cargo pants was at Costco. And they were for boys and they were too big and it was way too, I wore them anyway, but I was very embarrassed every time I wore them. Also, I remember when flared jeans became the thing. So
I was
like, mom jeans were out, flared jeans were in, and I'm like, oh, I want some flared jeans. And I think my mom only allowed me to buy two pairs, one like jean, like blue jean and one black jean. And she's like, but otherwise you have to wear all the rest of the jeans that you already have, because she did not believe flared jeans were going to be a thing. Well, they lasted like 15 years, mom. So I literally wore those two pairs of pants, just like rotation every, so it was like, you know, sometimes it was like the black jean three times and then the blue jeans two times every single day for like a year. Cause I was, I could not wear those mom jeans. And now mom jeans are in again.
And now they're in and you have a pair.
I certainly do have a pair. And you know what? I actually look good in them, I think.
You do.
I mean,
Full circle.
But those are things. It's like, you're embarrassed as a kid. You're like, oh my God. But also, she did teach me about, like, it's, don't just blow all your money on clothes. Like, who cares? And because also, like, then the next year, also, I was growing. So it's like, they didn't fit
exactly.
The next year. So, like, she, you know.
And literally in 6 months, usually, things will have changed.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, exactly.
This is a very nice question. Mm-hmm. What is your favorite thing about each other?
That's cute. Do you want to go first? Or do you want me to go first?
You go first.
Okay. My favorite thing about you.
Oh.
I
don't think either of us know.
I don't think we know. Let me just think of something on the spot. I would say you are very thoughtful.
Oh.
Yeah. You're a very thoughtful person.
That's
sometimes
very nice.
Too much. Sometimes you think too much about other people. But I think in general you have really good intentions and you're very always like thinking out for other people.
Thank you. That's nice. Mm-hmm. I would say mine is, I very much admire your go-getter ability and your ability to just be like, I'm going to do this. Mm-hmm. I will figure out a way to do it. I'm just going to do it.
Yeah.
And that's both in personal and business for you.
That's true. That's how I met my husband.
That's
I like him. He's going to be my boyfriend.
Pretty much.
He didn't have a choice.
No, he did not.
You know, I hear that from some people, like, oh, how do you, you know, try all these things, or where do you get that drive? I've always had some sort of drive. I don't know where it came from. I've had it since I was I'd say starting in like middle school. And it honestly was sparked by, I think, people not thinking I could achieve things. Yeah. Like,
so you prove them wrong.
Sure. And they're like, well, I'll show you. And I definitely have that I'll show you mentality still a little bit. But I don't know. I think it's not that I just I'm fearless. I'm certainly not fearless. I'm afraid of everything. It's that I basically I'm afraid of the thing and I do it anyway. Like I literally force myself to do the thing anyway. Kind of like, I don't know what's a good example, but
starting this podcast.
Well, starting this podcast, I mean, that was terrifying. But it honestly, like, to give you kind of a weird visual, it's like someone opening a door and it's like the Arctic or something that's super cold. You're like, I don't want to go in there. That seems really cold, but I need to, like, you know, go a few miles or whatever to pick up this golden chalice. I don't know what I don't know where I'm going with this, but let's just see where this happens.
Indiana Jones?
I don't know. Maybe it's a bit of Indiana Jones. And they're like, I don't want to. But then you're like, well, hell, I'll just do it anyway. And then you get into the cold, you walk, and it's really hard. But then you get to the kind of the, you know, the reward at the end. It's like doing something uncomfortable to get to a point that you're more comfortable. And it really just starts with doing one thing that terrifies you and then doing another thing and another thing and another thing forever.
And ever.
Like, honestly, like, it really started, I started really trying this out. I mean, it started, you know, really, I guess, when I applied to film school. Like, I don't think most people know this because I talk a lot about how I went to SFU for film. But the first year that I applied, I was rejected. I did not get in. So that was a big failure and knocked my ego. But also it was great because I'm like, you know what? That's okay. They say you don't have like enough experience or whatever. I'll apply again the next year. And then the next year I got on their waiting list. So I still didn't even get in. I was kind of devastated. I was trying to make other plans. And I'm like, should I go to BCIT and their video production program? And then I luckily got in. Someone dropped out and I got in. And that's, you know, how I got it. So it's like, that was like a thing that was terrifying. There was some failure involved and I did it anyway. And I just, it all worked out. But yeah, then slowly, especially after I finished university and, you know, that's when I realized, okay, in order to get to where you want to be in life, you have to be uncomfortable and you have to be afraid of things, but then do the thing anyway. And just embrace those feelings that feel so terrifying. Feelings. The uncomfortable, like the anxiety, the fear, the possible regret, the shame, the embarrassment, like all of the negative things you can think about, you may encounter those. Do the thing anyway. You may surprise yourself because it may actually be good on the other side.
And also, usually what you're thinking of the worst possible scenarios are very far reaching.
Usually they're just not. Like ridiculous. Yeah. You're like, everyone's going to stop being my friend and I'm going to lose all my money and I'm going to have to move back in with my parents and I'm going to... Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, no, everything's fine. Like, honestly, that was a big fear of me and Josh when we moved to Toronto. We thought the first year we were not going to get any jobs and we sold all of our furniture and didn't know anyone in Toronto. And we're like, well, I guess the worst case scenario is we don't make any money. And then the little money that we have left, we will drive back to Vancouver and move back in with my parents.
Yeah.
And that would have been, you know, embarrassing because we literally left. Be like, we're going to be so successful. Bye. We're going to be so great in Toronto. That's why we're leaving, because we literally left so we can just kind of kickstart our careers. And so it would have been really devastating to be like, so that didn't work out. Can we move back in?
But you know what? Even if that did happen, you would have found a different route. So it's fine.
Yeah. Yeah. It's fine. And sometimes I find I work very good under extreme circumstances.
Yeah.
Especially if it's things that like, oh, I'm so close to failure. That's usually when, like, I don't know, something happens and I like kind of move a switch to overdrive. And, you know, then you kind of surprise yourself with how capable you actually are.
True. And then I'll just add to that. One of the things that I also love about you is your sense
of... You said
of
love.
I said love. I said love. It didn't sound like sisters. Sense of humor.
Oh, you think I'm funny?
Yeah.
That's nice.
You think I'm funny?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah, there you go.
We have the same sense of humor.
I mean, it's going to be... I will have to listen back to this episode.
I hope there's some funny parts.
I hope so, too. I'm also just thinking... Will we sound like there's only one person speaking?
Because we sound identical.
Because we sound the same.
I think my voice is deeper than yours.
I think so too.
Yeah.
But we'll see.
You'll find out if you're confused with who the hell is talking. Sorry.
Sorry.
Can't help it.
Sisters.
Sisters.
That's a weird thing that we do.
Ew. Okay.
Yeah. So that was pretty much.
Those
were the questions.
Well, I guess this is time to wrap it up. Do you want to wrap it up? And I'm actually just going to wrap it up because then it was like 10 minutes of us just talking about things that were irrelevant to the podcast. So anyways, thank you so much for listening to this episode. This is episode 294. In case you're wondering, Sarah is going to have to re-listen to this episode and write the show notes. I hope you really enjoyed this special interview that I did with my sister, Sarah. And again, if you want to hear our original interview, my gosh, I should probably re-listen to it because it's been years. It's episode 53 from 2016. Gosh. So yeah, hopefully you enjoyed this special kind of bonus episode to kind of kick off season 13 of the More Money Podcast. For all the show notes of any episode ever of the show, just go to my website, jessicamoorhouse.com/podcast, or for a specific episode, just go to jessicamoorhouse.com/whatever the number of the episode is. And just as a reminder, make sure to follow me on Instagram. You can find me at Jessica I Moorhouse. And if you also want to follow my sister, Sarah, well, hers is at Sarah J Moorhouse. How weird is it that we both did first name, middle initial, last name? That's weird. But hey, didn't even know that until I just looked at our Instagram today. You can also follow me on Twitter at @JESSI_Moorhouse. And I also have a YouTube channel that has a lot of great videos on there that very different than the podcast. So you can find me. It's just go to jessicamoorhouse.com/YouTube or, you know, Google Jessica Moorhouse inside YouTube and you'll be able to find my channel and subscribe it. Very exciting that I was able to, you know, pass the 10,000 subscriber mark over the summer. Very exciting. So anyways, that is it for me. Thank you so much for listening. A big shout out to my podcast editor, as always, Matt Rideout. And I will see you back here next Wednesday with a fresh new episode of the More Money Podcast. Until then, have a good rest of your week. Have a good weekend. See you soon.